Hi, I'm Marty Otañez, a producer and host of Getting High on Anthropology. Welcome to another episode. This episode, we have Art Way with the Drug Policy Alliance. Art, welcome to the show.
Nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
So for starters, tell people about the Drug Policy Alliance, mm-hmm. and then what's like an ordinary day for you, the kind of activities you do in the organization.
Right. Well, we've been around since about 2001, and you know, to put it bluntly, we're looking to end the drug war. We think there's an over-reliance on the criminal justice system to address issues of drug use, drug dependency, as well as the illicit drug market. And we're looking for to establish a public health approach to deal with these issues, because ultimately, you know, they're behavioral health, mental health issues, and not issues that really should be solely dealt with within the court system and by law enforcement.
Excellent. And you've written a lot. You've been involved for several years. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, in the last couple months, what has been one of the challenges that you face and then one of the victories that you achieved in the area of cannabis?
Well, we established a revenue stream, which is an annual revenue stream from the Marijuana Tax Cash Fund to fund four adult pre-diversion booking programs across the state of Colorado. So this is a $6 million annual allocation. Technically, it's in perpetuity. So, you know, lately I've been playing that budget game and really trying to put the marijuana tax dollars to work in the ways that the voters expected them to be, you know, for broader drug policy purposes, to address more serious issues when it comes to public safety and public health. So we're, you know, those the RFP for those jurisdictions to apply for those dollars will come out soon. We hope to get, you know, about eight different applications from across the state. The State Department of Human Services will pick four jurisdictions to get this pre-booking diversion program started.
So for people who are new to the diversion program, so unpack it. Like, how would an ordinary person benefit from these programs?
So for an adult drug diversion program, that's pre-booking, what you have is law enforcement being on the front lines to providing services for those who need them, as opposed to simply arresting them for the drugs in their pocket. So this is a way for police to play a role in a public health approach, and as well as it's a way to minimize the jail population of a specific jurisdiction. You know, petty drug possession is a top five reason in across the state and across the country when it comes to city jail populations. A lot of those people cycle in and out of the city jail, but their dependency and their addiction remains. So with these type of pre-booking diversion programs, an officer can come across someone in need of help, and then simply putting them in jail, hoping and praying that they receive help there, they can actually take that person to 24/7 case management services, where that person will be signed up in the diversion program. It's individualized treatment and wraparound services. So it could be anywhere from drug treatment, anywhere to making sure that person has clean clothes and a place to stay, transitionary housing, really stabilizing these chaotic drug users' lives in order so they can be like, yeah, you know what, I think I would like treatment now.
Man, it's so interesting because it seems like a lot of work needs to be done, because at the moment there aren't such programs. And then also you're asking law enforcement to be rewired in a way.
Right.
And so are you hopeful that some of the projects that come out might have some short-term impact? And what gives you that hope?
You know, the infrastructure, like you say, is really not there. But what this policy looks to do is introduce harm reduction on a big level throughout law enforcement in the state of Colorado. Harm reduction says you may not be able to stop. You know, there's other things we can do to improve your life other than abstinence. So, you know, what can we do on a day-to-day basis to make you better, despite the fact that you're still using and you might not be ready to quit? So this policy does not require abstinence. You know, we're not asking people to pee in a cup. We're just looking to provide a trajectory to make their lives better day-to-day. And it's a game changer when it comes to law enforcement, because it changes their culture. And it provides another incentive structure, as opposed to simply looking to make a certain amount of arrests to maybe receive federal funding. A program like this, you know, asks and interjects within that incentive structure, how many people did you put into the LEAD program in the last month? You know, what did you do for the chaotic drug users in your community over the last month and over the last year? Will we be able to show a benefit and therefore get more funding moving forward down the road? So it definitely changes law enforcement culture. It will help us create a more harm reduction and treatments focused infrastructure within these jurisdictions. And hopefully after 3 years, after these first four jurisdictions are measured, we'll be able to expand it across the state even more.
Okay, so a lot of interesting things in the pipeline.
Yeah.
So what about for folks who aren't familiar with the LEAD program? What is that, and what's the relationship with that and, let's say, cannabis use in Colorado?
Well, the LEAD program is what I just explained. That's the pre-booking diversion program entitled Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion. So law enforcement are crucial in that, they basically have the discretion based on the parameters that their jurisdiction, that their DA, that their treatment community set for that policy within their jurisdiction to divert people into that services. When it comes to the relationship with marijuana, these programs are being funded by marijuana tax dollars through the marijuana tax cash fund. We aren't likely to divert marijuana users in the LEAD program. Ideally, the LEAD program addresses what are considered your frequent flyers when it comes to people who are in and out of the city jail, people who are dependent on meth, heroin, cocaine, and other type substances. So, we've been decriminalizing marijuana for so long in this state and in the city of Denver, even prior to legalization, that it's rare that, people are going to jail for possessing small amounts. And even though there's such things as cannabis use disorders, that type of disorder does not rise to the level of the demographic we want to attach to the LEAD program.
Gotcha, and I appreciate you clarifying. Mm-hmm. So going broader and back a couple years, could you talk about the intersection between cannabis reform and criminal justice reform? So apparently they've worked together, and I'm wondering, in 2017, are you happy with how they still work together, or do you find there is room for more support within the cannabis reform movement to assist the criminal justice reform movement?
It's been an interesting evolution. When I came aboard in 2011, we had one legalization effort in the country prior, and that was Prop 19 in California in 2010. Prop 19 failed, but that was the first time where you saw NAACP, the National Latino Police Officers Association. It's the first time you saw traditional criminal justice reform groups get involved in legalization. And, my role in Amendment 64 here in Colorado with Drug Policy Alliance was to continue that trend in 2012. We also got Servicios de la Raza, Colorado Latino Forum, NAACP, Rocky Mountain Chapter, on board with legalization, ACLU of Colorado. And we really tried to show that this is not simply about championing the wonderful plant that is cannabis and the flower that is marijuana, but it's about removing this wonderful plant and bud from the criminal justice system, because the criminal justice system was using it as really a gateway into their system. We felt like marijuana users did not belong in the criminal justice system to the level that they were being targeted historically throughout marijuana prohibition. And so we really tried to phrase it as, you all historically have always talked about how wonderful marijuana is, but it's bigger than that. It's a criminal justice issue. It's the first shot and kind of the first leverage for us to really start to explain what a public health approach to drugs looks like. Now, for marijuana, that's legalization in our opinion. For cocaine, heroin, we don't agree that legalization is the best public health approach. But we do believe that decriminalization of all drugs for simple use and possession is a solid first step. And then you reallocate the resources saved, the judicial resources saved from decriminalizing, into your treatment infrastructure and to address those who really truly have a problem.
Is there a model that you've seen worked really well where people decriminalized effectively?
I think Portugal worldwide is the common example. What they did in Portugal was, they They have a Department of Ministry, a Department of Health, and a Department of Justice. The terminology may not be exactly correct, but basically they took the issue of drug prohibition from a use and possession perspective out of their Department of Justice and put it into their Department of Health. So there's no crimes for possessing and using a certain amount of drugs in Portugal. And what they do instead of arresting people is, if an officer comes across the same person maybe once, two or three times, what they do is they send that person to what's called a dissuasion committee, where that committee is made up of law enforcement, public health, treatment, judicial folks, and they sit down and figure out if this person has a problem. And if they don't think the person has a problem, they say, have a nice day, hopefully we won't see you again. But if they do, they offer treatment for that person. It's not mandatory, but if that person is able to engage in the program, all criminal charges, not that they were ever filed, but that person would not suffer any criminal sanctions.
It seems so easy. So what's the problem? Why can't we
For one, our government, when it comes to healthcare, does not operate similarly to what, they have in Portugal. We do not, they basically have like a single payer system, whereas our system is not established that way. Not everybody here has health care, not everybody pays into health care. Obamacare did change the game a little bit. The Affordable Care Act did provide our country basically its most largest and historic drug treatment program to date. Because what the Affordable Care Act said was, we're gonna look at mental health issues and substance abuse and put them on par with physical issues. So that opened the door for a lot of people to get treatment primarily through Medicaid. But we just don't have the same system that Portugal has where we can wholeheartedly remove drug use and possession out of the criminal justice system and place it somewhere else. I mean, that's essentially what we try to do on a day-to-day basis at Drug Policy Alliance, but we don't have the federal framework to do it. We have to do it piecemeal through states and through jurisdictions and trying to build it as we go.
Got it. What's amazing about the work you do is its connection to this history of the drug war. Mm-hmm. So could you talk briefly about what are the racial consequences of the drug war?
Right. Well, the drug war has always had a classist and a racist bent to it. The very first prohibition in this country when it comes to drugs or paraphernalia was against opium smoking in California, in the San Francisco and the Bay Area. It wasn't against opium itself, and it wasn't against laudanum, which is an opium product that was sold at the time in pharmacies across the country, but it was against actual opium smoking, because by making opium smoking illegal, you were able to focus on Chinese immigrants who were opening opium dens at the time. The first cocaine laws in this country came out of the South. At the same time when African Americans were leaving the fields and no longer sharecropping and finding work in places like Mobile in New Orleans. And you couldn't make that migration illegal, but you could make something affiliated with that community illegal. That was the time of jazz and so forth. So they affiliated cocaine with the African American migrants moving into the cities and taking jobs that belong to white people essentially. Marijuana prohibition began when we saw in the middle of the early part of the 20th century, a lot of Mexican migrants moving out of Mexico, as well as Central American migrants moving out of Central America, moving into the United States, getting jobs at the GM and Ford factories across the Midwest. That's when you saw your prohibitions against marijuana. So drug policy has always been about keeping tabs on certain people. It's a way for those in power to be able to put their hands and their eyes and their resources to disrupt a certain community that they're concerned with at the time. Marijuana prohibition did not begin from an academic, scientific perspective that said, this stuff is by far dangerous to your brain. They made up a bunch of stuff along those lines, but none of that was ever proven.
It was
all propaganda. I mean, I give talks and high schools often. And so I when we talk about this racist, kind of fascist, classist history of the drug war, I bring in, propaganda from the 20s and the 1920s. And, there's pictures of the Negro cocaine fiend, big black buck, basically, carrying away a white woman. Mm-hmm. They have the same type pictures of the marijuana, Mexican migrant, marijuana delinquent. Juvenile delinquent, and they have evil pictures of Chinese folks, and they all like are carrying away white women, mm-hmm. So the drug war, it's intertwined, racism and classism is intertwined in the drug war. There's no escaping it, and it helps to explain the type of disparities we see nowadays, where at one point in time all the federal offenders in federal prison for crack, 90% of them were black, in a country where we're only about 13% of the population. Wow. That type of disparity does not happen by accident.
I'm so glad you introduced the class race perspective, mm-hmm. because those two are so intertwined. And right. even if you graph that onto the current cannabis industry, the way it's situated, mm-hmm. whether it's access to capital to open a business, yep. or being able to count on one or two fingers the African-American owners of cannabis companies themselves. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we got reconnected recently with this video that dealt with the link between gentrification mm-hmm. and the cannabis industry. And you were a bit critical because the purpose of this video with Candy and Ray was to highlight how a particular zip code in Denver has mm-hmm. the highest number of licensed facilities, and people in the communities feel they aren't getting what they right. should get, like a fair share. But let's talk about, what was your kind of critique about that? It was sort of like, maybe we were saying it's not as bad as the people in the video portrayed it to be?
No, I think this narrative that legalization caused gentrification is what I'm critical of. Because as a Denver native, and my family's been here, four or five, six generations, I can tell you that gentrification has a longer history than legalization. But I do think legalization was kind of the frosting on the cake and kind of the last straw that broke the camel's back to a certain extent. And so I just wanted to, always put forth the reality as I see it, that gentrification is a decades-old, issue, and legalization did not cause gentrification, but did it make it worse? Probably so. And I think it's been interesting that, marijuana legalization has become a microcosm of structural inequity. Mm-hmm. As criminal justice reformers, we had tunnel vision focusing on, let's remove marijuana from the criminal justice system, or let's have a carve out. Let's take this drug that is the reason for 60% of nearly of all drug arrests in this country, at least 40%, and let's remove that, and let's see how the powers that be adapt. We had tunnel vision, but we weren't thinking about economic intersectionality. We weren't thinking about structural inequity, and we weren't thinking about the capital powers that be or that are created when you have a new billion-dollar industry unleashed on a community. And so, we talked earlier about the evolution of marijuana legalization into the broader criminal justice realm. Now it's evolving into the broader economic intersectionality realm. And we're looking at DPA to ensure that there's more equity in the marijuana legalization efforts that we support moving forward. DPA was not behind Amendment 64, in the way that we were behind Prop 64 in California, where, it does have a lot of equity inclusions written within the initiative. And I hope to bring some of those Prop 64 type style equity pieces into our regulatory framework here in Colorado.
So if you were called as part of a team to go to a state that's about to craft legislation to, do cannabis reform, mm-hmm. any one or two points that you would encourage people to include to minimize problems of cannabis-related gentrification or some of the other problems that sort of are offshoots of the cannabis legalization movement?
Well, there's ideal things you would like to see happen, like you involve the community in the campaign. But when it comes to ballot initiatives, and even mostly legislative work, that just rarely happens, to be honest with you. But you do want to ensure that, you know, those who were impacted previously by the drug war in a disproportionate fashion are able to take part in the industry to some level. So, you know, you don't want a drug felony to be the only thing that excludes a person from taking part in this industry. You want to ideally establish a licensing structure that does not require someone to either, you know, have capital upwards of $500,000 to $3 million to get a license and play ball. You want to revise your Controlled Substances Act to where, you know, marijuana not only is legal for those 21 and up, but you decriminalize for those 21 and under, so they no longer bear the brunt of the current prohibition that still exists after legalization. You want to make your criminal justice penalties retroactive. So not, you know, we legalized in 2012, so, you know, the first day after that, everybody could walk around with an ounce in their pocket, you know. But, you know, ideally we would have been able to make that retroactive for those who were arrested in 2011, or not really arrested, but just have this on their record. And the collateral consequences that goes with having something like that on their record, it should be automatically expunged.
It seems so simple.
Yeah,
especially
yeah.
when you look at, like I had conversations with people as I try to explain Colorado, and they're not here, and they say, does this mean all the people who are incarcerated, they get to go free now? Because
right.
you know, all these lily white people are making a lot of cash.
Yeah.
And so there's all these inequities. But you mentioned the youth, and I know ages like 10 to 17, mm-hmm. Brown and black kids usually are the targets of some of these unfair policies. So do you have any knowledge about, since reform, changes in arrest rates, any patterns that you've noticed that have been interesting? Or I've heard you talk about in other presentations, expulsions, and then what are some of the remedies to these problems?
You know, across the board, since legalization, we've seen a decline in marijuana-related charges and arrests anywhere from 40 to 70%, depending on the charge. The only places where we've seen actual increases involves public consumption of marijuana. And then we saw an increase from 2013, in 2012 to 2013, juvenile arrests 10 to 17 dropped, but then it went back up, not higher than previous years of before legalization, but from 13 to 14 it went up pretty dramatically compared to 12 and 13. And you know, that's primarily, you know, most of these arrests are taking place at schools. You know, you may have heard of the school-to-prison pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's just a couple school districts and a couple schools within the state that really decided to set a strong message to their kids that legalization was not for them. And you know, they made a lot of police referrals for possession, distribution, sharing, and so forth. So we saw a small uptick there. But an uptick in arrests in that category does not actually mean an uptick in convictions, because during the implementation phase, you know, we established Drug Policy Alliance, working with the State Commission on Crime and Juvenile Justice, a juvenile in possession of marijuana charge, similar to minor in possession of alcohol. So minor in possession of marijuana, similar to minor in possession of alcohol. And so what that does, it increased diversion opportunities. So you may get arrested for that, but since that law is on the books, the goal was to make sure that youth was diverted into education and those charges eventually dropped. So we're looking into that data point right now to see if that uptick in minor juvenile arrests actually equates to an uptick in convictions.
Mm.
But, you know, it's hard to find out because this is a jurisdictional by jurisdictional issue. And not all DAs even have diversion programs. But I think some of the bad actors, you know, Adams County, Denver, Jefferson, I'm pretty sure their DAs have diversion programs. So we're gonna find out if more arrests actually means more convictions. Not to minimize arrests, because that can be traumatic for a family, you know, especially if it takes place at school. And the goal is to do like what Prop 64 did in California, and basically make it almost impossible for youth to get arrested for possession. you know, for an 18-year-old to be arrested in California now for marijuana, they really have to be, you know, moving a large amount, right?
Bags.
So that, you know, that's the ideal approach. But at least, you know, we kind of saw this coming during the implementation phase and tried to put a safeguard in place. And now we just need to figure out whether or not those safeguards actually work.
You've been engaged for a number of years, and I'm curious, how has this taken a toll on you? In other words, how has your work affected you?
Well, everybody blames me for their rent going up. You know? So, you know, that's why I'm, pushing back on the whole notion that legalization created gentrification, because, you know, it's just not quite that simple. It's an easy thing to point towards. I was on this mindset before I got the job. You know, I was raised by my mother, my grandmother, and my great-grandmother. And, you know, my great-grandmother set me down when I was like 11. And she said, look, I want you to be drug-free, if possible, drug and alcohol-free. But to be honest with you, if you ever decide to make a choice between marijuana and alcohol, I'd rather you choose marijuana. So the whole notion that marijuana is safer than alcohol is something I grew up with, right? So, you know, the marijuana legalization campaigns were not that mind-blowing to me. So this was almost a validation of how I grew up to be able to work for Drug Policy Alliance and to be able to be involved in marijuana legalization efforts. So, you know, I don't think it's changed me quite a bit, but at the same time, it's such a complex issue when you talk about dependency and addiction, and it's such a big problem when you talk about the billion-dollar drug trade across the world and the way this country decides to fight it. You know, every day is a learning experience.
Well, Art, great place to end, and I've learned so much having you, and I really hope in the future we can do this again, because there's so many other kinds of questions. Even as a father, thinking what high school I should look at for my kid to make sure that there's a high school that handles this marijuana possession in the appropriate way. Mm-hmm. So I just want to thank you, and I appreciate the work you're doing. And thank you, everybody, for tuning in. And you've been watching Getting High on Anthropology. Tonight's guest was Art Way with the Drug Policy Alliance. You have a good night.
Thank you.